Good morning, sports fans, and welcome to the Saturday Morning Sports Show here on 97.3 WRUL and 93.3 WROY. The sports show is brought to you by a Little Giant Grocery Outlet, Rice Motor Company, Hale Body Shop, First Mid Bank and Trust, Wabash Christian Therapy, Bush & Associates CPAs, People's National Bank, Hamilton Memorial Hospital District, Rush Appliance and Furniture, Citizens National Bank of Albion, Nancy J. Winter CPA, Cherry Street Automotive, Farrell Hospital, Taylor Eye Care, Rorock Transport, Wabash General Hospital, and Invenergy Boomtown Solar. Cole Carter and Chris Myers, as later on today, the Carmi-White County Bulldogs are going to take on the Athens Warriors. Yes, it's Athens, those of you that have been wondering at home. In the first round of the IHSA football playoffs, both teams are 7-2. And Chris, we both had the chance to check out what we can about this team, whether it's stats-wise or film-wise. And there's no question the Bulldogs are going to start their playoff journey with a tough contest with the Athens Warriors.
Without question, they are. And this is a 7-2 football team in Athens that plays in a very rugged conference, to say the least. Now, two of the teams they played this year, one is a perennial power in Maroa Forsyth, who is made multiple appearances in state championship games in 2A football. Another being, I believe, Williamsville, another team that's made deep playoff runs consistently. They played Maroa Forsyth to a two-point game, and I believe the Williamsville game was a blowout. So this is a team that sees in that area they're at. They're about 30, 40 miles north of Springfield. They play very consistent, tough competition. So I have no doubt they're going to be a battle-tested team. Obviously, they're making the drive down here, but the one thing that kind of you're like, oh, no, here we go again, it's the dreaded double wing offense, something the Bulldogs the last 2 weeks, quite frankly, have just struggled with. So it's going to be interesting to see what kind of adjustments we've made, not only scheme-wise, but just how this team's mentality is after the past 2 weeks, especially after last Friday and what can be described mildly as just an extremely disappointing loss.
Yeah, I think mentally is kind of the biggest question mark here for Carmi. How are the Bulldogs mentally? Because obviously you lose to Johnson City, a great football team who we talked before the show today is probably going to make it to maybe the third round of the playoffs, if not further. That's a good football team, and they're the two seed in the South for a reason. And I think if you're Carmi, you feel okay after losing that game. But, man, just the way that things went last Friday and the concerns, especially on the defensive side of the ball for Carmi, Chris, if you're these players, the coaches, you have to put that behind you because at this point everybody is 0-0, and it's a brand new season.
Yeah, at this point, the positives are it's a new season. You just said it. I mean, you're in the postseason, which is your goal. It's exciting playing on a Saturday afternoon. Still going to have a great crowd. I know these boys are excited to still be playing football. You know, on the flip side is, can you survive long playing the brand of football we played last week? The answer is no, because there is zero. And I mean zero room for error in the postseason, because now you're playing Johnson City quality teams every week and better. So it's just the bottom line. Whatever was ailing the Bulldogs defensively has to be corrected, because you can't make any mistakes against a team coming in here from up north at 7-2 that has played in a really tough conference and runs an offense, that type of offense that our defense has just struggled to defend all year.
Well, it's an Athens team who was a really good team last year. They went all the way to the quarterfinals. They actually beat Cesar Valier in the second round, but they had a 2,000-yard All-State running back last season. He's gone. He's playing college ball, but this year they're going to share the love between three running backs, Cameron Biggard, number 21, Camden Austin, number 19, and their big guy, their number one guy, number 42, Corey Craig. He's rushed for over 1,200 yards and 18 touchdowns this year. Chris, I think comparing it to a Fairfield or Johnson City is a really good comparison. They don't necessarily go in the foot-to-foot on the offensive line. They're not huge up front. They've got a couple of guys with size. I think they're very comparable to us on the offensive line. Big guys, but you're not going to see any 6'6"s this week in Athens. But one thing I do notice watching their film is they get off the ball really quickly, and one thing that Kurt Simon said when I talked to him earlier this week, and we'll hear that here in a minute, is these three running backs are very aggressive and very physical when they run the football. We talked about how Isaac King, a lot of the times when he's running the ball, he'll lower his shoulder. He'll make the defender. He's hitting the defender. The defender's not hitting him. And that's how all three of these guys run. And so there's no question if these defensive backs for Carmi get themselves in a one-on-one position, try to make an open field tackle, it's going to be tough trying to bring these guys down.
Yeah, this is kind of a running back by committee team. You know, looking at their three running backs, Craig with over 1,200 yards rushing this season. Cameron Biggard had 783, and Camden Austin, their other back, 546 yards. So those aren't stats to sneeze at for any of those guys. That's a very well-balanced backfield. And, you know, it's one thing when you have one horse back there that, you know, okay, this guy is going to bring it every play. When you have three backs that are just, they're bringing it, as they say, every play, then your defense has to know tackling is critical. Missed tackles cannot happen because these guys, I mean, they're looking for contact. Yeah. And if you miss tackles, if you're not coming up aggressively and bringing it to them before they bring it to you, then it's going to be a long, punishing afternoon.
Yeah, people have asked me throughout the week, you know, is this is it a passing team? Because Carmine in the past, and even this year a little bit, especially last week against Florida, they struggle against the pass. And the answer to that question is yes, but not often. Their quarterback, Drew Cushman, has only thrown the ball 56 times this year. He's completed 22 of those, 39% completion percentage, 405 yards and three touchdowns. So I don't think the passing game is going to be the biggest threat for Athens. Again, it's a running football team. But Chris, this game, bottom line, is going to come down to the line of scrimmage. Our offensive line, their defensive line, their offensive line, our defensive line. And there's no question, if Carmi wants to win this football game, which they can do, this is a very beatable Athens team, they've got to get a push on the offensive line, and they got to get pressure on the defensive line.
Yeah, I mean, you just said it, Cole, in a nutshell. The play up front, we just have to bring our A game, and it has to be every single play. Johnson City had a lot of size. You know, they had a defensive tackle, 280, 285 pounds, who's going to play at the next level in college. I mean, that's a tough one.
Yeah.
Flora was kind of a similar type team, big, strong, and physical. And again, you can just point to, you know, that might have been part of why we were a little worn down last Friday. We were emotionally and physically worn down and just weren't up for the game. You can name a lot of things, some fluke plays they got. But at the end of the day, especially the second half, we were just never able to answer the bell when we had to. We couldn't get stops on third and long. You know, it just seemed like if we did get pressure, the quarterback was escaping. If we needed some yards on third and short, Florida was stacking, you know, 10, 11 guys in the box, and we just weren't getting the movement we normally get. We just weren't getting the hat-on-hat push that we're used to. And they were forcing us to do things out of our comfort zone that we don't do. So without question, because both of these teams are so dependent on the run game, it is up to your linemen, how they perform and how each man does his assignment and who finishes. You know, we in practice it's called a terminology called playing through the whistle. Well, when you're an offensive lineman, that is what has to be ingrained in you each and every snap. I'm blocking my man until I hear a referee blow a whistle. I'm not stopping until I got someone on his back. That's got to be my mentality. Defensively, same thing. I'm in the backfield every play. I'm looking for the football. I'm getting to it no matter where it's at. I'm doing my job until the whistle blows. You know, and going back to what we were talking about, Cole, you know, how they're not a huge passing team either. If you break it down, their 56 pass attempts, that's roughly six attempts per game.
Yeah.
You know, that's not a lot, but a little bit. Carmi, if you want to talk about little passing, ours averages out to two.
Yeah.
Two attempts. Warren Lake, 20 attempts the whole season. Four of those were last week.
Yeah.
So you break that down. Neither one of us pass a lot. But, you know, which you'll play in your conversation with Coach Simon, I think he has alluded to that, yes, we're going to have to integrate that more than we have because – where you've seen it the last 2 weeks, we are not a come from behind team. Mm-hmm. If we're down a score or more, we are not a team. Now, we did have that long 70-yard pass that worked, but I think it's because we finally popped it on when they weren't expecting. But when we're down and pinned down and teams know, okay, they can't run it now, we know it's not our strength. So if we're going to do it, we have to integrate it a little more at earlier times in the game. And I think you're going to see that be a factor today.
Yeah, you made a great point that obviously Athens, their number one thing to do list is going to be stop Isaac King. And I found an interview where their coach was talking about Carmi-White and said they got a great running back. Number one, that's pretty much all they need to know. And I think if you are Carmi-White, you're going to face a stacked box pretty much all day. They're going to stack six guys in the line of scrimmage. I saw a couple of some film of them playing a team similar to us where they had six defensive linemen. They had one corner that was almost like a off defensive end, two linebackers and a safety. That's it. Everybody inside the box. And and to your point, Chris, Carmi-White is going to have to, rather it's sending a wide receiver out wide, or you know, maybe I wouldn't say spreading things out, but you got to do something to give yourself some more breathing room in terms of opening holes and running the football.
Yeah, and it's going to have to be integrated a little earlier in the game, I think, Cole. You know, be it the play action pass, or just coming out in some type of spread look. You know, we do have that kind of a bunch set that we do throw out of sometimes, but six down linemen, two linebackers, two corners wide, one safety. One safety tells me, okay, I got room for two tight ends to run some 15 and outs, make that safety commit one way or another, and maybe I can slip a back over the middle. Or it's a great situation for screen passes, just anything. I think the pass, again, if we come out, you know, we're saying this, but if we're coming out and we're doing what we did early in the year, 5-6 yards a chunk, then okay, fine. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. But I think if it's in a stage where our first drive or two, we're looking at three and outs, then, yeah, we're going to have to look to mix things up a little more earlier. And I think that's going to be a very likely scenario this game.
You also made a good point. I in my opinion, that first quarter is going to tell us how the game is going to go. And you mentioned if Carmi, let's say, gets the ball first and three and out, Athens finds a way to score and facing a third down again. If you're Carmi, the biggest thing today, you cannot find yourself down two or three scores early in the game, because for one, we're not a team that's going to throw the ball a lot and can score three touchdowns in 3 minutes. And Athens, on the other hand, they're not a team that busts a lot of big plays. They're used to those 10-play drives that kill 8 minutes, a lot like Florida did last week. Yeah. They're used to running the ball and taking time off the clock, so there's no question. We need to start this game today like we started the game against Cesar Valier. Drove right down the field, scored on our first possession, got a pick six, was up 14-0, just like that. That is what Carmi needs today. They need to get off to a hot start.
Yeah, that's the X factor. Can we create a turnover? You know, most of the turnovers that we got this season, we capitalized on. I think literally every game that we either got a fumble recovery or a pick, it immediately led to a score. And I think that may be the difference in the game today. We need that kind of spark, be it early on, some point in the game, creating a turnover, a big special teams play. Field position will be huge. You know, if we're kicking off to them, our coverage team has to do a good job of keeping them inside the 30. We don't want them starting the drives at midfield. But I think what is critical to me, Cole, and we've talked about it, is if our weakness has shown, you know, that if we do get behind a score or more, we're not a quick answer the bell quickly. So that's the danger. You know, if we fall behind a couple scores, you know, not to play doomsday in the first half. I mean, then that takes us out of our rhythm of 3 yards, 4 yards, because now the clock is our enemy. When you're a run-heavy team, the clock has to be your friend, and when you're behind, it's not. So that forces you out of your comfort zone, out of what you do well. So I think the Bulldogs this week in practice have probably had to focus a little more on, you know, mixing things up a little bit offensively and work on the passing game.
You mentioned turnovers. Athens, they're plus +7 in turnover margin. They've only turned the ball over 4 times this year, 1 pick and 3 fumbles. Carmi, they're plus +12 in the turnover margin. Just 5 fumbles lost this season for Carmi. And Chris, that's going to be important. Like you said, you know, getting turnovers and not turning the ball over, that's going to be key for Carmi. And rather it's week 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or the playoffs, you can't turn the ball over. Got to take care of the ball. And for the most part, throughout the year, Carmi's done a great job, even taking the ball away defensively. Numerous interceptions by our guys when we've played some passing teams, and they're able to strip the ball out as well. There's no question, when it comes Saturday football time, knocking that football out, it looms large.
Yeah, and that's the thing we've talked about, that it's taught. defensively anymore. It's not so much, you know, tackling. Obviously, good, solid, fundamental tackling is number one. But defenders are taught now to almost strip the football. Yeah. At any opportunity, if a running back doesn't keep that ball tight to his body, either when he's approaching the line of scrimmage, two hands on the ball, or when he's breaking away, anytime you see that ball tucked away from his body, then that thing is vulnerable to be swatted at, hit from behind, stripped, what have you. So, you know, for both teams, you know, ball security will be important. Running backs hanging on to the ball. Turnovers, as you say, a turnover could be devastating in this type of game for either team. But, you know, those margins are incredible. Carmi plus 12. Only mm-hmm. 5 fumbles lost in a 9-game season. I mean, any coach would take that. That's a tremendous plus ratio there. Yeah.
And I feel like for the past 15 minutes, we've been talking about Athens this whole time. And mainly because it's a team we're not familiar with and just trying to let the fans know what to expect today. But talk about the Bulldogs, though. I mean, this is a team, Chris, obviously the last 2 weeks have been what they have been. Obviously not fun. You don't want to think about that, but the way this Bulldog team played in the first 7 weeks of the year against some pretty solid teams in the BDC, a couple of playoff teams, Cesar Valier and Fairfield, and Isaac King. I mean, he's one touchdown away from pretty much breaking every single record in Carmi history. If he scores a touchdown today, he will break the single season record for most touchdowns in 1 year for Carmi. Last week, he broke the all-time rushing yards record and the all-time touchdowns record. And I made the point, Chris, obviously Athens is going to be focusing on the stopping Isaac King, mm-hmm. but I'm pretty sure every team has tried that this year and it hasn't worked.
Yeah, it's the old adage, you can't stop him, you can only hope to contain him.
Yeah.
So, and yeah, he will be the focal point. But to me, this is a key. This is where Draxod, Andrew Dodson can have a chance to shine. This is where maybe the Tyler Gomet, Nate Browns on some play-action passes can have a time to shine. You know, this team, these two teams not knowing each other, Athens coach said, we know, number one, it's King. They got an all-state running back. We got to focus on him. Well, to me, this is the time these other young men who've played very, very brilliantly this year as well have a chance to shine. You know, we've seen Odd on several occasions make some gritty runs mm-hmm. on some third and shorts, some fourth and shorts, and get us some tough yards to convert and move the chains. Dodson showed some breakaway speed. So to me, these two are going to have to step up, which I know they will, and say, hey, you know, put the ball in our hands too. I think this is where Carmi has to diversify their offense a little more.
I had the chance to talk to Kirk Simon at practice earlier this week. Here's what he had to say about Athens.
Well, Coach, from the first couple of days of watching their film, what stands out about Athens?
Very physical. Very physical. They run a similar offense that we do, but they get off the ball well. Their three backs all run the ball really hard. Haven't seen many turnovers. They don't put the ball on the ground. And then, of course, defensively, they're the same way. We have to play better. We have to play better. It's not no secret to winning games like this. There can be no turnovers, and you got to play the best game you played all year.
Obviously, the last 2 weeks you want to forget, but what's got to change from your team from the past 2 weeks in order to get a win on Saturday?
You know, I don't. You know, we can say all kinds of things. I think us and Johnson City did a similar thing. You know. Johnson City played Cesar right before they had to play us, and Cesar probably should have beat him if there was a pretty bad call at the end of that game, and you know, probably overlooking him a little bit. Our Florida game is sandwiched right in between the Johnson City game and our first round playoff game, and you know, maybe I didn't do a good enough job preparing our kids. I'll take the blame for that, but we cannot come out and be lackadaisical and not playing really hard and expecting Isaac to run a 50-yarder. I mean, it's got to be a collective, awesome effort by every kid on the field. And I think it was, you know, in a lot of ways, you say that all the time, but it might have been good for us. And I think you're going to see a great effort out of our kids. So that's the biggest thing. It's a mental thing. I mean, you know, for 7 straight weeks, we scored 50 points a game, and we're moving people off the ball and doing things the way you're supposed to do it. And so I think we just got to get back to doing what we do best, and that's running the football.
Obviously, this is going to be a game that's going to be one up front. You can expect them defensively to put 5-6 guys in the line of scrimmage, 9 guys in the box. Kind of what's your guys' plan offensively to still open some holes despite them really crowding things up front?
No special plan. Got to play better. I mean, you got to play better, got to block better, got to run better. Backs got to block for each other better. We just have to execute. You have to execute, and, you know, there's going to be times when you get stymied at the line of scrimmage. You got to line up and get a lot of white in your knuckles on the next play and not let it happen the next time. You know, we can probably do a little bit better job doing a little bit more play action, but in general, I think to win the game, we're going to have to keep the ball from their offense and do what we do best, and that's hang on to the football and, you know, get first downs and burn clock.
Injury-wise, Gavin Payton left the game last week. I saw him practice today, assuming he's good to go on Saturday.
He's good to go right now, and I don't know from a percentage where he's at. I think he's I think he'll be, you know, 90% by Saturday. So he's looked better and better every day this week.
And in playoff games, special teams are important too. Mitchell Edwards, I saw he had a helmet and pads on he's today. Back. Is he good to go as well?
Yep, he's back as well. So hopefully, we get the kicking game back where it was, and everybody's firing on all cylinders.
Well, it's been 6 years since we had a playoff game here at home. How good is that going to feel on Saturday?
Feels great. Feels great. Feels great preparing for it. And, you know, we've been blessed with some great weather this year so far, and it still looks like the rain might hold off till Saturday night. So it can do whatever it wants Saturday night. But Saturday during the day, we hope it's a nice day and hope we get a good turnout. I'm sure we will. And the kids are just fired up about a home playoff game.
All right, Coach. Thanks. Best of luck on Saturday.
Right. Thank you.
He's not wrong there. Going to be great weather this afternoon for some football. High, like in the upper 60s. Sunshine, rain's going to hold off. It's going to be great weather today for some football. Chris, something I wanted to touch on also that I asked Coach about is the injury front. You know, Carmi has, knock on wood, been fortunate to not deal with too many injuries throughout the year, small things here and there. Saw Gavin Payton get hurt last week. The first thought was a broken collarbone. That was what I had first heard, and I thought, oh, that's not good. Wasn't that bad. He's going to be good to go today. And also Mitchell Edwards, even if he's just the punter and the kicker, special teams is very important in playoff games. I'm sure these coaches can talk about times in playoff games throughout the years where special teams have made the difference in ball games, and just to have Edwards that can give you a good kickoff, can give you a clean punt, could be the difference.
Oh, yeah. I mean, anytime you lose a key component of your special teams, I mean, it can be devastating. You know, I think Brandon Stockton did a great job last week
absolutely.
Filling in.
Yeah.
But, you know, you think about it, I've had this happen at the lower level before. I had center hurt his finger mid-game, and you try to put another kid in there cold to snap the ball, either in shotgun or punts. It can be disastrous, you know, just simply because of timing and reps.
It's all timing.
So, it's timing because that's something, you know, your kicker's practicing that every day. Your snapper's practicing snapping every day. It's consistency and rhythm. And when one of those two key elements goes down, your snapper or your punter, kicker, holder, whatever, it can definitely cause issues. And, you know, and that's something you don't think about. Special teams is so often taken for granted, but yet there are so many times – you know, the percentage that always used to be the rule of thumb was special teams are 70% of what determines a football game. You know, number one is the battle line of scrimmage, but special teams, because it's about field position. You know, if you can pin a team down deep every time you kick the ball off, or if you're punting, if you're deep in your territory and you get a monster punt and reverse the field position back, you know, that can save ball games. A kid making a wise decision to make a fair catch instead of trying to field a punt deep in the territory and fumbling. You know, just little things can make the difference in a football game.
You know, and that was something to me that seemed to be the difference in that Johnson City game that people didn't really think about was field position.
Yeah.
There was a couple of times where the Indians returned kicks and punts back to the Carmi 30, 35-yard line, and how many times in that game did Carmi have the football inside their own 30?
Oh,
and so
there's
no doubt in a game like this where it's going to be pound for pound grinding out yards at the line of scrimmage, field position means everything.
Yeah, I mean, that Johnson City game, you know, we had the lead at halftime. A lot of us forget we had the lead, even though it didn't seem like we had momentum. We saw the lead on the scoreboard, but, you know, and the opening drive was going to be critical. You know, could we make a stop? Well, in the opening kick, they take down to our 30.
It didn't help. We still got to stop.
We got to stop, but we're backed up inside our 10, and then we had to give it back to them. The next drive, they score. And, again, it was a great job, but it goes back to field position. We were punting from our end zone, you know, and that's just the unforgotten part of a football game is the special teams. And I think – If we're able to win the field position battle in terms of not starting deep in our own territory, and conversely, keeping them on their side of the field on kickoffs, deep in their territory, making them have to really work to move the ball. You know, if they don't get, you know, because the games we've watched this year, if a team is at midfield in high school, it's usually four down territory in most cases. Yeah. College, and that, not and that so much. Pros, today, not so too. Much. Yep. But in high school, yeah, it's definitely going to be the case.
Yeah.
But if you're inside your 35 and it's fourth and three, that's different. Now you're punting. Mm-hmm. So that's why field position is so important, especially in high school football.
And the playoffs have not been the most kindest of events for the Bulldogs, and they've really just had some bad luck in the postseason, really, in the past decade or so. Chris, I'll ask you two questions, and you cannot look at your paper for the answer because I have it right in front of you. Okay. Last time Carmi won a playoff game, can you recall that?
Well, I was looking earlier. 2013, they won the first round against Chester.
Chester,
ended up losing. Who they played the week before, I believe. At that point in the year,
it was week eight. It was late in the year. You are correct there. Yeah, they went to Chester, which is never an easy place to play. And the Bulldogs have a chance to possibly play in Chester next week. It's not likely. That's on Chester's behalf. They're 5-4. They're playing Decatur St. Teresa today. But my next question, pretend like you don't know, but the last time Carmi won a home playoff game.
Now, this one I will have to think. I want to go all the way back, and I'm not using the cheat sheet. I want to go all the way back to 2006.
That'd be correct.
Second round against Red Hill.
That's correct.
And that was an upset. Red Hill was higher seeded than us, and that was considered an upset.
Yeah. Won that game 22-13. But and I don't mean that to in a bad way by any means. It's tough to win in the playoffs. It's bottom line. It's tough to win in the playoffs. Carmi's had a couple of home games since then, but they've played a couple of really good teams. I can recall back in 2016, the last time the Bulldogs did play at home in the playoffs, they played a Shelbyville team that went all the way to the semifinals that same year. So it always comes to that conversation that when you get to the postseason, you are playing teams that you haven't seen, and you're playing teams that are in good conferences up in the Central Illinois area, and that's just kind of been what Carmi has ran into time and time again.
Yeah, and I think just not we have discussed in the past, not just Carmi, but I think the entire southern region is going to face that. You know,
today.
Yeah, you look at Johnson City's draw, getting Florida first round. If they play how they should, that should be a win.
Mm-hmm.
Second round, Johnson City be looking at playing Vandalia, even though Vandalia is 7-2. You know, they're up in that central part of the state. They're playing some tough competition. You know, if Johnson City, not to get too far ahead of myself, would win round two, round three, they're finally going to be looking at a Shelbyville, some really dominant team program that's making consistent quarterfinal, semifinal runs every year. So, and to talk about Athens, their playoff history, conversely, looking at the sheet here, they have been in the playoffs every year for the last 12 seasons, since 2010. 10 and 11, they were first round. 12,
Man, they've won a playoff game each of the last 9 postseasons. Yeah. Of course, not counting the 2020 COVID year.
Yeah, going back to 12. So, I mean, that's impressive. Yeah. And they were a semifinal team back in 2017. So it's just, you know, this is an established program. Yep. This isn't just someone that's bad and having a great season. This is a consistently established, dominant football program that's coming down here to play. And that's just going to give you an idea of the competition level the Bulldogs are looking at. But, yeah, it would be great to see us get a win, because the last deep playoff run we had was in 06 when we did go to the quarterfinals again and lost to Casey, who I think eventually might have went to the state championship that year. Run, so.
We'll go ahead and take our first break of the morning. We come back, we'll look at the other playoff games going around here in Southern Illinois and throughout the entire state of that. It's a Saturday morning sports show right here on 97.3 WRUL and 93.3 WROI.
When it comes to income tax planning and preparation, experience counts. Experience to know all the deductions that you can take. Experience and knowledge to keep up with the ever-changing tax laws, rules, and regulations. Hi, I'm Keith Butch, and owner of Butch & Associates CPAs in Carmi. For 42 years, I've helped people just like yourself for your tax, auditing, and accounting needs. Stop in today at Butch & Associates on Main Street in Carmi. Call 382-4151 or visit butch.com. That's B-O-T-S-E-H.com.
October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. In-house mammography services at Wabash General Hospital utilize the latest technology and state-of-the-art equipment in Wabash General's newly remodeled radiology department. Annual screening mammograms are recommended for women beginning at age 40, and no physician referral is required for screening mammograms. Call today for more information, 618-263-6361, and schedule your annual screening mammogram with Wabash General today. People you know, helping people you love.
People's National Bank has two great CD specials for you. A 9-month CD at 2% APY and a 15-month CD at 2.5% APY. Come in today to take advantage of this limited-time offer. Stop by any People's National Bank location and open a 9-month CD at 2% APY or a 15-month CD at 2.5% APY today. People's National Bank, member FDIC. Annual percentage yield accurate as of September 27th, 2022. $500 to open and obtain APY.
Ready for cold, snow, and ice?
Me either.
What about your car?
Ready or not, it's coming.
And now's the time to get ready.
Colder temps take their toll.
Heating systems, batteries, and tires all need special attention.
Winterize early and avoid a breakdown in the cold.
Visit Cherry Street Automotive in Carmine.
From oil changes to tire rotation, the pros will make sure your car is ready for winter.
Even if you aren't.
Cherry Street Automotive.
Your partners in automotive repair.
Call 618-382-7165 today.
That's 382-7165.
Taylor Eye Care on Falcon Avenue in Carmi has over 500 eyeglass frames to choose from in stock. Also, a large selection of designer sunglass, non-prescription or prescription. Taylor Eye Care treats every patient like a member of their family, going above and beyond the expected for a truly memorable eye care experience. Call Taylor Eye Care at 618-382-4683 for your next eye exam. That's 618-382-4683. Taylor Eye Care, excellence in eye care.
You and your family have depended on Farrell Hospital for over 97 years, starting when we were just a one-story hospital with 12 beds. As our community grew, we grew to provide more physicians and services. And today, we want you to know you can still depend on us to be here for you with the care and providers you need, right here, close to home. Farrell Hospital. You can depend on us.
Mom is so happy at Wabash Christian Supportive Living. She enjoys herself, loves the food, and I've seen a positive change in her health.
Hi, this is Kathleen Garner, Residential Service Director for Wabash Christian Supportive Living. And if your mom is still independent, but missing out on socialization, isn't eating properly, struggles to maintain her household, or just needs daily support, Wabash Christian Supportive Living is perfect. Wabash Christian Supportive Living even offers on-site therapy. As a faith-based organization, you'll both feel confident our actions and conduct reflect your standards. Learn more by calling 382-2900.
Celebrating 20 years of accelerating the clean energy future. Invenergy's Boomtown Solar Project will create up to 400 construction jobs right here in this community while creating enough electricity to power 40,000 American homes. Invenergy expects to invest $60 million in White County over the project's lifetime. Invenergy, innovators building a sustainable world. Learn more at Invenergy.com.
Welcome back to the Saturday Morning Sports Show here on 97.3 WRUL and 93.3 WROI. Cole Carter and Chris Myers, of course, later on today. The Carmi-White County Bulldogs are taking on the Athens Warriors in the first round of the IHSA football playoffs here at home. If you cannot make it to the game, we'll have all the action for you on 97.3 WRUL and on the WRUL Sports YouTube channel. Looking at the other playoff games going on in 2A today in the South Bracket, Decatur St. Teresa, they're going to take on Chester. That's the 1-16 matchup. Decatur St. Teresa predicted to win that game by about 52 points. So Chester,
Decatur St. Teresa has pretty well beaten everybody by that kind of margin this year. And they're, in fact, I mean, obviously being ranked number one, they were talked about early in the year. I'd heard buzz about them pretty much, you know, having a run to the state finals this year.
Oh, and if, and what's unfortunate for Carmi is if they win today, they've got to go up to Decatur and beat them. But, hey, you know, you never know what can happen, but there's no question that's going to be
that's the difference between 8-1, 7-2. No, that's where seedings can kind of come to haunt you.
Yeah. Other games going on in the area. Fairfield, they're going to travel up to Vernon North Mac. North Mac is predicted to win that one 35-12. Interesting to see how that game goes, because Fairfield, I thought, has played some really good football at the end of the year. I think ever since the game against us, that was week five, that was rivalry week. Ever since then, Fairfield has been a really good football team, put up 70-some-odd points last week against Vianna. I mean, I know it's Vianna, but I mean, if you score that many points, you're doing something right. I think North Mac is going to have their hands full against this Fairfield team.
Yeah, and Fairfield, a team that early in the year suffered a devastating blow. Their best player went down week one. A lot of people forget that. You know, this was a Fairfield team not at full strength. You know, you imagine us being without Isaac King's services after week one. You know, it was a devastating blow to them. So to their credit, they still put together a very solid 6-3 season, qualified for the playoffs. So, you know, let's see if they can go up there and make that a little closer than what the pundits are predicting.
Also going on in Johnson City, the 2-15 game, the 2-seed, the Indians, and the 15-seed, Flora. They've got JC winning this game 35-14, so a 21-point win for the Indians is predicted. These predictions I got from CalPreps.com, who's usually pretty accurate in terms of high school football predictions. But Chris, that's another game that I'll be interested to see what the final score is, because if Flora can play like they did last week, they're going to give the Indians a run for their money.
They will, but I think Johnston City saw that. They look at the scores of games, too, and I just don't see them having a letdown at home in round one. You know, they've seen Flora before. You know, I think it was just, again, looking back on it, and again, I'm not discrediting Flora. They did a fantastic job, played a great game, but I don't think they're going to catch Johnston City by surprise. I think Flora's opened their bottle with the Lightning last week, and I just don't see them, you know, doing the same thing at Johnston City.
Indians won that matchup earlier in the year, 43-15. That was back in week six when those two teams met. Also, in that same bracket, the 7-10 game, Vandalia will host Arthur. Vandalia, it's going to be a close one. The Vandals are predicted to win that game by 7, 35-28. So anytime they predict a game that it's a one-score game, you know it's going to be a ball game that could go either way. The 3-14 game, Shelbyville, they host Belleville-Altoff. The Rams are predicted to get a big win there. Shelbyville, that is, 34-7. And then the last game in the South bracket, the 6-11 game, Redbud will host Nashville. Both teams are 7-2, and Redbud predicted to win by 2 points there. So that will be a couple of these first rounds. And usually in the first round, you don't know what you're going to get. Usually it's a lot of, you know, the higher seed just beating down on the lower seed. But there could be a couple of games.
I think that's one of those games where, you know,
could see an upset.
I think so. I think so too. People don't realize Nashville, a couple of their losses were, and one of them was against Carterville.
Yeah.
And they had played Carterville, I believe. It was a 7-7, 14-7 game for two quarters. Carterville finally pulled away. But Carterville is expected to make a deep postseason run in 4A. This Carterville team was 9-0 and as good as they ever were. You got those. Pulling up the schedule here.
Yeah, up Nashville's schedule. So their two losses, they lost to Freeburg back in week two, 38-20. And then that loss to Carterville, like you said, 28-7.
Yeah. Two tough teams.
Yeah, absolutely. You know?
So, I mean, like I said, the Carterville Lions could easily make the semifinals in 4A this year. And you know, Nashville played them well for, it looked like, 2-3 quarters.
Yeah.
So I really think Nashville is going to win that game myself.
Looking at some games of local interest in the 3A bracket, Harrisburg is going to travel to Tolono Unity. That's today at 2 o'clock. Tolono went all the way to the state championship last year. They beat Mount Carmel in the semifinals last year. Mount Carmel will host Monticello today at 2:30. That's the 5-12 game. The Aces are 8-1 after losing to Mount Vernon at home last week. Benton is the 2-seed in 3A. They're 8-1. They're going to host Olympia, the 15-seed. That's today at 3 o'clock in Benton. Robinson, they're going to play at St. Joseph Ogden at 3 o'clock. Carlinville, actually, I stand corrected. Pretty much all the local teams there in 3A that are in action today. Interesting to see that Mount Carmel matchup to see if they could see Tolono Unity again next week. Going over to the 4A bracket now in the southern part. Talked about Carterville. They're the number one seed in the South. They're going to be at home today at 1 o'clock against, how do you pronounce that, Chris? Geneseo? I haven't seen that
Geneseo.
One before. Geneseo. That's Geneseo. A new one for me.
Yep.
Geneseo, they're going to play them today at 1 o'clock. And then, let's see, Effingham, they are at Rochester. They're 5-4, pretty much getting pretty far out of our area. In terms of 4A, Alney, they're going to be at home against Waterloo. And Murfreesboro is also at home against Columbia. And let's see, check out the 1A bracket. Not sure if any local teams are in the 1A side. I know Cesar Valier, they are at home. They're going to take on Central A&M Moequa today at 2 o'clock. That game, again, is in Cesar. And Red Hill is also at home. They're going to play Salt Fork at 2 o'clock today. So a lot of area teams in action throughout Southern Illinois, but a big matchup today in Carmi as the Bulldogs host Athens in the first round of the IHSA football playoffs. Again, that's coming up at 2 o'clock today. The pregame show will start at 1:45. We'll take our final break of the morning. We come back, we'll have our national sports segment right here on the Saturday Morning Sports Show.
Great teamwork is no accident.
David and the gang at Hale Body Shop salute the area athletes.
Just as in sports, the team at Hale Body Shop work together to make sure you get your car back as quickly as possible.
When it comes to collision repair, more and more people choose the team way out there on Possum Road.
Hale Body Shop in Carmi.
David and the gang are proud supporters of area athletes.
Yep, you heard it right.
Citizens National Bank of Albion is this area's five-star and most trusted banking partner.
We make it easier than ever for you to set up a new account.
Take advantage of our mobile deposits and the latest in banking technology.
Sign up for our incentive account, earn cash back, and watch your money grow.
And need a loan for a new vehicle, home, business, or farm?
Come in and talk to our lending professionals today.
Citizens National Bank of Albion, no better banking.
Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
You can buy more of what you want when you save on what you need. Save on meal ingredients by shopping Little Giant Grocery Outlet in Carmi. Little Giant's team of buyers are constantly scanning wholesalers, looking for pantry favorites and meal ingredients at astonishing savings just so you can shop confidently, knowing that you can come in anytime and find great deals from fresh cuts of meat and grocery items to deli, fresh produce, and frozen goods. See just how much more your dollar buys at Little Giant Grocery, Carmi, Illinois.
Miracles do happen. New inventory is rolling in at Rice Motor Company in Carmi, Illinois. I'm Scott Rice, and we have more new cars, trucks, and SUVs in stock since the beginning of the pandemic. New Chevy Malibus, 36 miles per gallon. The hot new Chevrolet Trailblazer. 10 new GMC and Chevrolet half-ton pickups. The all-new Buick GX SUV at 30-plus miles per gallon. Chevy Equinox and GMC Terrain SUVs all in stock now. Hurry, demand is high. Over 30 new Chevys, Buicks, and GMCs in stock now. Only at Rice Motor Company in Carmi.
Your family's care team is close to home at Hamilton Memorial Family Clinics in McLeansboro and Carmi. From routine care, vaccines and DOT physicals, to disease management, x-ray, lab work, and COVID testing. With 9 providers and 8 specialty care clinics, Hamilton Memorial has you covered. Plus, for those unexpected illnesses, our weekend walk-in clinics in Carmi and McLeansboro. Hamilton Memorial Hospital Family Clinics. Here for you now, like we've always been.
Nobody goes into business because they love tedious paperwork, unless you are an accountant. But those tasks are essential to having a successful business. From beginning to end, we can help you with the details of payroll, accounting, and taxes, leaving you free to focus on the big picture. Good at what we do, so you can focus on what you love. Phone 382-2364, Nancy J. Winter, CPA, Cherry Street, Carmi.
Family owned and operated for more than 70 years, Rush Appliance and Furniture stands the test of time. We have a large selection of in-stock furniture and appliances for every room in your home, grills and smokers, and an unmatched dedication to superior service. This is Sean Rush inviting you to visit me in Fairfield or my dad, Terry, in Carmi, where we can help you furnish every room in your house with superb service after the sale.
ProArc Transport in Carmi has earned a reputation of dependable hauling that many in this area have depended on. ProArc Transport now also offers rock, dirt, and lime hauling. From parking lots, driveways, and washouts, ProArc Transport can handle all your rock and dirt hauling needs. Farmers can also depend on ProArc Transport to deliver their lime when and where they need it. For your next driveway or parking lot job, remember ProArc Transport for fast, dependable service. Call ProArc Transport today at 265-3665.
Harvest means long hours and hard work, and planning ahead for what's next. As the third largest ag lender in Illinois, First Mid Bank and Trust has a team of ag professionals who can help you make profitable decisions for next year. Whether you want to add more acres, upgrade equipment, or make seed purchases for planting, our ag lenders can help, because we know how important it is to be ready for what comes next. Talk to a First Mid Ag lender today. First Mid is an equal opportunity lender.
For DC Metal, building for life.
Every project starts with the first step. Custom design a new building online at dcmetal.com. Explore their 3D drawings, truss drawings, color selection tools, and a gallery of photos to help inspire ideas. Once you have everything just the way you want, print your final look or request a free quote online. Just visit dcmetal.com.
Building for life, DC Metal.
Welcome back to the Saturday Morning Sports Show here on 97.3 WRUL and 93.3 WROI. Again, later on today at 2 o'clock, the Carmi-White County Bulldogs will be playing the Athens Warriors here in town. If you cannot make it, we'll have all the action for you on 97.3 WRUL and on the WRUL Sports YouTube channel. Should be a great game between two great football programs. But again, there's no question, Chris, Carmi, they've got the abilities and they have the potential to beat this team. There's no doubt about that, but they got to play their best football of the year.
I think the Carmi football team that needs to show up is the Carmi football team we saw against Cesar, the team we saw against Fairfield.
Yep.
And honestly, I mean, you can point the Johnson City game for, you know, three and a half quarters, you know, for three quarters against Johnson City. You know, we had a 22-7 lead. If that football team shows up, plays their consistent brand of dominating the line of scrimmage, moving the chains, getting, you know, converting third and three, fourth and two, wins the time of possession battle, doesn't turn the ball over, and gets consistent stops on defense, doesn't give up third and longs, I think you're going to see us have a very, very good chance of winning today. But if the team that shows up last week shows up, again, not to be Captain Negative here, Blunt, that team can't show up today.
Yeah.
That team I don't want to see again.
Yeah.
That we need.
And I think
boys,
everybody can agree with that.
Everyone can agree with that assessment. This team definitely has the capability to win this game today. They just got to recover mentally.
Yeah.
I know they're going to be excited, going to have a good crowd. It's a great atmosphere. Maroon and white on a Saturday afternoon, playoff football in high school. It's just a thing of beauty. If you don't have anything going on, I encourage everyone in this community to come out and watch the game today. Regardless, it's going to be a beautiful day. Just the atmosphere alone is worth it. Come out and support these kids. Great group of kids. Let's see if we can get us a home playoff win today.
Well, I know I'm excited, but how excited are you to have Saturday football back in Carmi? It's been 6 years since we had a home playoff game. There's nothing like Saturday football
just
in Carmi.
Love it. You know, I go back to I was fortunate enough to be on the high school staff back in 2003 when we had that deep playoff run. One of the players was Coach Kevin Wolf, mm-hmm. who's now on the staff. And just, you know, that first round game especially, just getting to the stadium that morning, seeing people, the stands filling up early, seeing little, you know, barbecue grills around, people tailgating,
yeah.
and seeing, you know, the balloons flying, banners up with kids' names on. The atmosphere is just different. It's just different once you reach the postseason, and it's different in a great way. So, again, I encourage you, if you can get there tomorrow, get there. It's just going to be a great afternoon.
Absolutely. Don't listen to me and Chris on the air today. Be at the game.
Yes.
But of course, if you're out of town, more than welcome to listen to us. Again, we'll have the broadcast on 97.3 WRUL. The pregame show will start at 1:45. You can also watch the game on the WRUL Sports YouTube channel. Now on to our Terrible 10 picks for this week. Chris beat me again last week. He went 7-3. I went 6-4. Both of us missed a couple of NFL games. I almost texted you because it was Saturday afternoon when the Broncos announced that Russell Wilson was not going to play. I almost texted you and said, this game does not count because I wouldn't have picked the Broncos.
You wanted a mulligan.
I wanted a mulligan, exactly.
I would have to do the prices right.
But I'll take the loss. It is what it is. But overall, Chris leads the standings. He's 30 games above 500 at 55-25. I'm about to wave the white flag. I'm 43-37. But we will take a look at this week's pick'em, and even going to throw in a couple of high school playoff games in this week's pick'em. Starting off on the college level, though, a big game today in Pennsylvania. Number 2, Ohio State at number 13, Penn State. Who you got, Chris?
I got the Buckeyes, and it won't even be close.
Really?
Yep.
You don't think it's going to be close at all?
No. Two scores minimum. Okay. Ohio State by 14.
Ooh. Okay.
Final answer, sticking to it.
I will go with the Buckeyes as well, but I think it will be a close game. It's a tough place to play. Penn State's good. They couldn't play well against Michigan for whatever reason, but yeah. I will go Buckeyes in a close contest. Number 19, Kentucky at number 3, Tennessee. I'm going with the Volunteers here.
I am too. You know, Kentucky was kind of a surprise pick earlier in the year. They stubbed their toe against Ole Miss. You know, kind of what they do, start out strong, and then they really stubbed their toe against South Carolina. Got back on track in their last win, I believe, against Mississippi State. But the Vols, man, after what they did to Alabama, they're the real deal. Yeah. They're headed for the college football playoff, yeah. So I have to go with Tennessee as well.
Now on to the high school football playoffs. A couple of games in 2A and one of the 1A games. In the 1A side, number 7, Sester Valier. They're hosting number 10, Central A&M. I'll start with you, Chris. Who do you got?
Well, you know, even though there are competition during the year, you always want to see our conference do good. So, you know, being the higher seed, I'll go ahead. And Sester was a team, you know, like we talked about, they were a bad call away
Points away from beating Johnson City.
And they had the lead with, what, like 2 minutes maybe left in that game? Yep. 2-3 minutes. Johnson City scored late to come out and win that game. You know, and it's a Sester team that we just, you know, we just caught by surprise. I'm not downplaying. We played a
outstanding
phenomenal
game.
But, you know, it's a talented team. I'm going to go ahead and take Sester. That was my long-winded way of saying I'm picking Sester.
I'm going to go against you here. Central A&M is one of those teams that comes from a conference up north that's really good. I saw them play Albion a couple years ago in the playoffs. I know that was, you know, the kids that are playing now weren't even in high school then, but year in, year out, they produce good teams. I'm going to go with the Central A&M Raiders here.
All right.
Central and Mowiqua. If anybody was wondering where that school's
Mowiqua,
at.
A lot of Indian names there. Geneseo Mowiqua.
In the 2A South side, I should have done more or less a spread for this game, because I think I know who we're both going to pick. But Johnson City against Flora. Then we're both going to go JC here, pretty obvious.
Yeah.
Convincingly, I think Flora will keep it close in the first half. Maybe a 28-14 halftime game, maybe something like that. But I think, Indians, they'll get the win handily today. Also, 2A South game of the Black Diamond Conference team in play. Fairfield traveling up to North Mac. I have no idea about North Mac, but I do know, like I said, Fairfield's played better football at the end of the year. I'm going to take North Mac, but I think it might be a close game.
I'm going to take North Mac. I think Fairfield will make it somewhat respectable, but if they're predicting 35-12, I think Fairfield might keep it to a couple scores.
Yeah.
Maybe a 35-21 type game.
Yeah, I would agree with you there. Now on to the NFL side for tomorrow. Tomorrow morning in London, Broncos against the Jags. The Jags, it's their second home. Who you got here, Chris?
Well, I'm going to go ahead and go with the Jags, given that the Broncos, I don't know if they could score a touchdown in the Black Diamond Conference.
They're hard to watch sometimes.
Yeah, I think they'd struggle to score in our conference.
Yeah.
So.
And I can't say much about my Steelers either, but I'm with you there. But I picked the Broncos last week, and they bit me, so I'm going to go Jags here. Again, they play in London every year. It's like their second home, so it's like a home game for them. Also, tomorrow afternoon, the Cardinals at the Vikings. I think I know James Conner for the Cardinals is not going to play in that game, if that makes a difference. But regardless, I'm going Vikings at home.
Yeah, Cardinals did pull out a win the other night.
They did?
I'll go ahead and lean towards the Vikes. You know, I usually have pretty decent luck when I pick the Vikings. Yeah.
It's a noon game.
Noon game,
so Kirk Cousins is going to be. Another game tomorrow in the NFL. This one should be interesting. The New England Patriots and the New York Jets. The Jets, the J-E-T-S, one of the hottest teams in the NFL. With that being the case, Patriots don't know who their quarterback is. Is it Mac Jones, Bailey Zappe? I'm going Jets.
I'm going along with you. J-E-T-S, Jets, Jets, Jets.
Yeah, it's really annoying when you're a Steelers fan going to a Steelers Jets game surrounded by Jets fans, and they every single play, it's J-E-T-S, Jets, Jets, Jets. Okay, I get it. All right, tomorrow late afternoon, the New York Giants, who are one of the biggest surprises in the NFL, they're traveling to Seattle to face another surprise team, the Seattle Seahawks. Who you got, Chris?
I'll go with the G-men on that one. I think, you know, they're offensively, they got a little bit more than the Seahawks do. So
You're correct there in that regard, but Seattle's a tough place to play. The Seahawks whooped the Chargers last week in L.A., so I'm going with the Seahawks here. And again, we've picked almost every game identically, so I got to go with the Seahawks here against the Giants. Final pick tomorrow night, Sunday Night Football, Packers at the Bills. I'm going Bills by two or three scores.
I'm with you there. Yeah. I'm probably done picking the Packers. They are. Pick a pack. I'm not picking a pack.
and the Bills might be the best team in the NFL with the way they have played.
I think they are.
In the past couple of weeks. Yeah. So there's our Terrible 10 pick-ems for this week. We'll see if either me or Chris can. Again, we had pretty much the same picks except for two, so we'll see if either of us can, if he can get more of his lead in the division or in the standings, or if I can maybe cover some ground. And Chris leads it. He's 55-25. I'm 43-37. So, Chris, before we hit the road and get ready for this afternoon's game, again, what's going to be the biggest key for Carmi to get the win today?
The biggest key for Carmi for me is, can the defense get three and outs?
Yeah.
For me, is can our defense get our confidence back? Can we not give up big plays? More importantly, when third and longs, we've got to shut teams down on third and longs, get them off the field. So I believe offensively we can do what we do. You know, we're going to have to integrate the pass a little more. But for me, the big key is we have to play much better defense today.
Yeah. I think it's starting out hot and having big plays. You know, whether it's a long run by Isaac or a long pass from Warren, whatever it may be, some big play that the even if it's early in the game, hopefully it's early in the game, but it gets the crowd going, gets the team fired up. Because I also feel last week there just wasn't a whole lot of energy with the team, and that's. But hopefully we can get a big play earlier in the game, whether it's an interception, a fumble, a nice kickoff return, whatever it may be, to get this team sparked early and put the pressure on Athens out the gate. That's going to be the biggest key for Carmi. Put the pressure on Athens early in the football game.
Yeah.
So that's going to do it for us this morning here on the Saturday Morning Sports Show. A big thanks to J.C. Tinsley across the hall getting us on the air. And again, coming up at 2 o'clock, the Bulldogs and the Warriors. We'll have the Taylor Eye Care pregame show for you on 97.3 WRUL and the WRUL Sports YouTube channel at 1:45. So for Chris Myers and J.C. Tinsley, I'm Cole Carter saying have a great weekend, Bulldog fans.